ici. Welcome to the 4000 series, a series initiated by Rob Sound Strange and a couple of other guys, fine men. I was invited to participate in this series by Sher, Julius Jabbar. The series is about referencing and talking about every single entry in the 4000 series of the Blue Note catalog. A series that many consider changed the fate of jazz. And it's difficult to argue against that. Most of the greatest and most timeless jazz sessions, at least by American musicians, can be found in the 4000 series. But the crowning achievement, in my opinion, I'm so honored to have been chosen to talk about this. Eric Dolphy, clarinet. Eric Dolphy, Out to Lunch, 1964. Blue Note 4163. Plenty of people have talked about this and have said how great this album is. People often also say that it is a crown achievement in its genre. I don't really understand that. I don't want to put this in a specific category of jazz. This is just a jazz record, and in my opinion, this is just the best jazz record ever. Funnily enough, this is the first jazz record I bought as well. Back in the, I believe it was in the late 90s, I was heavily into electronic music, and mostly bands like Oetker and Aphex Twin, but mostly Oetker, which are all about the weirdest time signatures, and it's very percussive music, and the freedom is absolute in a way. And but I was also in different kinds of music, but not really into jazz. I knew about it and I had a ground knowledge of it, but no personal history with it. And so I was still going to a few record shops in Paris, jazz record shops, because whenever they had something interesting that wasn't jazz, you could get it for really cheap. And one time I was in this shop called the Paris Jazz Corner, up in right by the Jussieu University, Les Arènes de Lutèce, and suddenly this was playing. I was friendly with the guys from the shop already, and they thought that it was funny to see me looking for everything that they were not interested in. But and I was talking with them about what I found interested in it. So I believe that they might have played this because they knew I was into rhythms and this kind of freedom. And so this really turned my head, and I asked what that was. They gave me a little blurb. They explained to me that this was also the original pressing, which is why it was so expensive. It turns out it's not the original pressing. This came out in 64. This is the edition from 1966. In very, very good shape though. So an early edition, and they kind of, they went around the truth. They didn't, Well, it was still the most expensive record I ever bought back then. I believe I paid something like 90 bucks or so, 80 bucks maybe. It is in really perfect shape anyways, but it's not the first press. I don't care. It sounds great and it's beautiful. And that was really the record that put me on the path of getting into jazz. So for the next 2 years, every week I'm in the every jazz record shop in Paris, buying everything I can that strikes my Bobby Hutcherson. And after 2 years I realized, man, you weren't in love with jazz. You were learning, because after 2 years I realized I was in love with this record. But I was in the process of learning a foreign language, until suddenly it clicked and jazz became a mother tongue. It all started with this, and I had to make the whole of jazz history that was infused to me, into me, match this quality or this this level of ambition. This features, of course, Freddie Hubbard on trumpet, who was an old friend, I believe, of Eric Dolphy, as Richard Davis is the real old friend. Then Bobby Hutcherson, he was starting to be on fire, and Anthony Williams, a mere 18 years old, even if he had played professionally for 5 years or so already. Yeah, that was something else. I don't think there was that much jazz back then, especially on Blue Note. I mean, Sonny Murray was playing like that probably, but you wouldn't find that kind of drumming on a Blue Note record back then. And just a few years before, when Dolphy is doing this with amazing Ron Carter cello, by the way, but this is so different, so more conservative in a way. I mean, this is really unfair to say so, but I enjoy this now, but this is not as challenging at all as this. Even if this is very easy to listen to in a way, but it's challenging just in a how would you put it, in an efficient way. What changes, in my opinion, is just a year after that, I believe the beginning of free jazz, for me at least, is Eric Dolphy playing the solo on Ride Midnight for George Russell on his Aesthetics album. Just a few months before free jazz, the Ornette Coleman record, where Eric Dolphy is also featured. And so as you can hear in this track that is almost finished, Eric Dolphy is the incarnation of generosity. Everyone's got his solo. Let's listen to this again right after this. And it's a composition, but it's filled with improvisation. You can hear all the parts, all the solos are improvised, but they all glue back together into this theme that everyone agrees on and tunes in. Let's get back to this magic. This track is called Hat and Beard, which is why I look like that today. Sorry, the beard is not as big as it should be, but Julius and Mazzy, who's after me on the line of who's contributing to the series, were eager for me to finish this. So, the hat and the beard. The record also got like, it's only got 5 tracks. It was recorded in January 64. They had played all together some months ago to get acquainted to the band, and there was a couple of days of sessions later, years, decades later, 2 alternate takes of 2 tracks of this session were released. I believe it was this track and probably Straight Up and Down or Something Sweet. Anyway, Something Sweet, which follows, is more aligned to a ballad. It's good, it's really good. Dolphy also plays the clarinet, but it's a really good song. It's just still a little bit connected to the past in a way. Whereas on Gazzelloni, the 3rd track on the A side, which is an homage to a great classical music flute player from Italy, I believe, you're back to this. It starts as a modern bop track, very classic in a way. Let's get back to why I'm not a fan of the tenor saxophone. But yeah, after like a few bars of Gazzelloni, chaos. Improvisation, madness, greatness. Then you have to turn on the B side with the title track, How to Lunch, which is great, is really great. It's more conceptual, there's less melodies that are as catchy. Everything is catchy in Hat and Beers, let's be honest. It's unique in the sense that it is so wild, but it's also beautiful. All the it's a pop tune almost in a way. You can anticipate a few things, and as soon as you heard the track a couple of times, you just rejoice with the anticipation of what you know is coming. All the turns and angles, genius. So Out to Lunch is really good. Quite massive, conceptual, and the last track, Straight Up and Down, is totally conceptual. Eric Dolphy wanted to evoke a drunken musician walking. It's more skeletical, like there's less of everyone playing together. It's very interesting, but let's be honest, the highlights of this are the first track, Head and Beard, and Gazzaloni. But let's focus on Hat and Beard just a little while more. Because now we get Freddie Hubbard, who starts his solo in such a classy way. But also in a sneaky way, because you could expect something. Oh, and there you see, this, you already know you're not into the usual modern bop fare. I love how it sounds almost stubborn in its terms. Oh, and Bobby Hutcherson in the background, just very slowly underlying the harmonics of the Freddie Hubbard solo. Of course, everyone has his moment in this, and the upcoming Bobby Hutcherson solo is just something for the ages. Eric Dolphy was quite a... He was brought up in a religious family in the on the West Coast before he migrated to New York. And there's stories about how when Coltrane first visited Los Angeles, he was housed by Eric Dolphy's family, by his dad, who I believe was a minister or priest or something. Anyways, he was really shocked by the generosity of Eric Dolphy. And when they toured together in the early 60s in Europe, that was also something that really shocked Eric Coltrane to the point that it almost bothered him, because he didn't know really what to give back. Bobby Hutcherson. Yeah, this is a personal take, but for me, Coltrane is... there's some kind of selfishness in his music. He needs the players to play for him. With Eric Dolphy, it's very clear. He needs people to play with him. He barely needs to play himself, actually, which is kind of the same philosophy you would find in someone like Dollar Brand. This album that I absolutely cherish called The Journey from Dollar Brand, with featuring Don Cherry and just 10 other great musicians. Dollar Brand is barely doing anything apart from keeping the rhythm, keeping the structure, and everyone has their way. This is what happens here, but way before. And I think this is revolutionary. I mean, you expect that from jazz, but to that extent, that's very rare. And so Eric Dolphy, he was playing with everyone, and he never really managed to achieve success with his music. He was basically quite poor in a way, and that was also something that, that was, I think, driving him, that he was really detached from material things in a very different way than Coltrane. And well, there's this quote actually in the liner notes that about his future after this recording. "I'm on my way to Europe to live for a while. Why? Because I can get more work there playing my own music, and because if you try to do anything different in this country, people put you down for it." Eric Dolphy is a very emotional, sensitive person, obviously. And I think that is really what draws me to his music and what drives tons of other people. This album is called Out to Lunch, but if you look close to the cover, it also says, "We'll be back." That didn't happen. He died 6 months after that. He did a few recordings in radio stations in Europe, mostly in France. He toured with people. He finished a few things, a few featuring there and there, but this was to be his last album as a leader. So the irony, I'm almost emotional speaking about this. But yeah, let's go ahead to Gazzaloni. So this was basically, Out to Lunch is offering a path for the future of jazz. This is five musicians under the spiritual direction of a genius. Four other musicians that are themselves geniuses in the making, if not already, but not on the level of Eric Dolphy, in my opinion. And they do this album, and something ends. Also, the market shifts in America. There's no room for jazz as a popular form of pop music, popular music. But people, I mean, this is not forgotten. And the people who contributed to this, of course, I mean, they try to replicate the magic. Bobby Hutcherson on compounds, with Freddie Hubbard. But most of his records from the 60s that dates right after Out to Lunch, you can feel that he wants the magic to continue. I would argue the same about Anthony Williams and his first album and his second album, Spring, or is it the third? And even later in his life, as his long departed friend still is in his mind. Richard Davis featuring, yeah. This is just a great record, but this is much later. This is 1975, so, and I believe Richard Davis is the only one who's still with us from this session. I think he'd be 90 years old or so, and he was profoundly marked by this session. And of course other people took notice, obviously Andrew Hill, to the extent that even Eric Dolphy plays on this. This is Andrew Hill's career after Out to Lunch is also different, and up to his death, the generosity and the ambition is there, and few American jazz musicians reach that level. That is sad that you would never get this again, in my opinion. I mean, sure you do, probably, to a certain level, but I mean, things gotta end. It's just a shame it did so quickly. What's a shame also, sorry again, sure, is that I had to take that much time to make this video. Not that much, but in France, usually when you're up for a task and it takes some time to do it, maybe you procrastinate a little bit. Well, when you realize that you should be done with it and you're still not, if you're growing a beard, you stop shaving and you decide that you will shave only when you're done with this. So this is the moment. New man, well, good enough for YouTube, maybe good enough for you, fellow 4000 series, definitely not good enough for Eric Dolphy, the greatest looking guy in jazz, in my opinion, with one of the greatest moustache and the one who pulled off the best muff there. I don't like these things. I know you have a proper beard. He did it really good. And he's not featured here, but look at this great looking dude. Eric Dolphy, ladies and gentlemen. Out to lunch. A milestone in jazz, free jazz, modern jazz, music, human experience, human history. An album that has been reissued many times. I bought this many times. I gave this many times to friends, even if I knew that we're never gonna be really into it. But this has become a part of me. And thank you, Julius. Sure. To allow me to talk about this to this extent. I don't know if it was interesting for you guys, but I like doing this. So this was Stunt Rock Confusion, and I don't always talk about jazz, even if a third of my collection is jazz. But if there is one record to talk about, that would have been this one, and maybe some French jazz. Michel Portal on the clarinet, he is pretty good as well. Bye for now, VC.